This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. The Methods and Scope of Genetics, an inaugural lecture, delivered the 23rd of October, 1908 by W. Bateson. Prefatory note. The professorship of biology was founded in 1908, for a period of 5 years, partly by the generosity of an anonymous benefactor, and partly by the University of Cambridge. The object of the endowment was the promotion of inquiries into the physiology of heredity and variation, a study now spoken of as genetics. It is now recognized that the progress of such inquiries will chiefly be accomplished by the application of experimental methods, especially those which Mendel's discovery has suggested. The purpose of this inaugural lecture is to describe the outlook over this field of research in a manner intelligible to students of other parts of knowledge. W.B. The 28th of October, 1908. The Methods and Scope of Genetics. The opportunity of addressing fellow students pursuing lines of inquiry other than his own falls seldom to a scientific man. One of these rare opportunities is offered by the constitution of the professorship to which I have had the honor to be called. That professorship, though bearing the comprehensive title of biology, is founded with the understanding that the holder shall apply himself to a particular class of physiological problems, the study of which is denoted by the term genetics. The term is new, and though the problems are among the oldest which have vexed the human mind, the modes by which they may be successfully attacked are also of modern invention. There is therefore a certain fitness in the employment of this occasion for the deliverance of a discourse explaining something of the aims of genetics and of the methods by which we trust they may be reached. You will be aware that the claims put forward in the name of genetics are high, but I trust to be able to show you that they are not high without reason. It is the ambition of everyone who in youth devotes himself to the search for natural truth that his work may be found somewhere in the mainstream of progress. So long only as he keeps something of the limitless hope with which his voyage of discovery began, will his courage and his spirit last. The moment we most dread is one in which it may appear that, after all, our effort has been spent in exploring some petty tributary, or worse, a backwater of the great current. It is because genetic research is still pushing forward in the central and differentiated trunk of biological science that we confess no guilt of presumption in declaring boldly that whatever difficulty may be in store for those who cast in their lot with us, they need fear no disillusionment or misgiving that their labor has been wasted on a paltry quest. In research, as in all business of exploration, the stirring times come when a fresh region is suddenly unlocked by the discovery of a new key. Then conquest is easy, and there are prizes for all. We are happy in that, during our own time, not a few such territories have been revealed to the vision of mankind. I do not dare to suggest that in magnitude or splendor the field of genetics may be compared with that now being disclosed to the physicist or the astronomer, for the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. But I will say that for once to the man of ordinary power who cannot venture into those heights beyond, Mendel's clue has shown the way into a realm of nature which for surprising novelty and adventure is hardly to be excelled. It is no hyperbolical figure that I use when I speak of Mendelian discovery leading us into a new world, the very existence of which was unsuspected before. The road thither is simple and easy to follow. We start from a common fact, familiar to everyone, that all the ordinary animals and plants began their individual life by the union of two cells, the one male, the other female. Those cells are known as germ cells or gametes, that is to say, marrying cells. Now, obviously, the diversity of form which is...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.